Welcome to the forge, my wanton wildlings. I'm your creepsmith, and I hope you like my work. Hey, wildlings. Just wanted to give you a bit of a warning here. This one's bad, even for stories about a Cronenbergian dystopian drug trip. The more sensitive might want to give this one a pass, okay? Still here? Then here we go. The Flesh Interface series, posts 36 through 40, by 9Mother9Horse9Eyes9. 36th post. Our form is our story. Our form is our story, the story of all the world. The world does not sleep. Everywhere, 10,000 different things are darting, skittering, flitting, scuttling, burrowing. Sleep is righteousness, but the world wakes. We are made in the image of the world. The world is a giant of our kind, and we live on its back. Its trees and grasses and hills are like the hairs on our backs. Our paws are soft and our ways are subtle and silky, so we are in harmony with the world. But everywhere, 10,000 things are scuttling, out of harmony, and it causes the world to itch and suffer just as the little scuttling things on our backs cause us to itch and suffer. So the world cannot sleep, and everything turns and spins, and we cannot sleep. For we are made in the image of the world. This is why we hunt. This is our duty. To hunt out all the little scuttling things, to devour them, to expel them, to bury them back into the world, leaving no trace. We must hunt, night and day. We hunt the 10,000 things on the world's back, just as we hunt and clean the little scuttling things from our own backs. One day, we will destroy all 10,000 things, and then the world will sleep. And we can sleep. And everything will sleep forever. This will be a great righteousness. We can feel this righteousness every time we sleep. And we can feel a great injustice every time we are woken. So we hunt. So we must hunt. This truth is in our bones, in our claws, in our form, for we are made in the image of the world, and our form contains all truth. Our form is our story, the story of the world. But now, we are confronted with a great mystery. We do not abide mysteries. They plague our sleep. We must solve them. What is hidden must be uncovered. So we search and we sleuth. But this mystery eludes. It scuttles and slips away time after time. And we do not sleep. But it seems there is no hidden message in our form which gives us any answer. Is our form incomplete? I, above all others, have become obsessed with this mystery. The mystery of the oily ones. 37th post. A team of doctors from Berlin. One day, during the final summer, a team of doctors came from Berlin. They were in the midst of a grand experiment, which they considered to be of the utmost importance and needed access to a large number of prisoners, something beyond of what they could acquire in Berlin. We protested that we were not equipped for any sort of medical experiments, that our camp was designed for a single purpose, but they insisted, and we were forced to accommodate them. I was immediately irritated by their senior doctor, a haughty man in his late 40s named Engel, who always wore a crisp white coat and fine leather shoes. He arrived with his team of doctors, and I could scarcely believe it, a Jew. This was perhaps the ugliest Jew to have ever personally offended my eyes. He was a very tall man, a full head taller than average, with a furry black beard, a gnarled claw-like nose, and very prominent eyes. These eyes were something of a source of fascination to me, as they were not the rat-like black color of the normal Jew, but a much lighter shade of brown, almost like bronze. He wore a shabby suit and followed Engel around quite closely, almost as if they were associates. And always his strange flashing eyes were roaming about in a suspicious way. When I first met Engel, I asked who this Jew was, but my question was brushed aside. They immediately set about converting one of our buildings into a station for their experiments, the details of which were kept from me entirely. Engel and his team made no contact with the other staff except to demand various supplies. After a few days of being subjected to Engel's imperious behavior, I could feel that my SS subordinates and even the Ukrainians were smirking at me behind my back. So I decided to give Engel a tour of the other parts of the camp, which he had not yet seen. The part where we processed the prisoners. Of course, he refused, but I insisted. Fortunately, a trainload of prisoners was arriving at this moment, and we went out to the platform. The odious Jew with the glittering eyes followed us, which pleased me all the more. The train arrived, with the cries of the passengers blending into the squealing of the metal wheels. The blue units worked themselves into the usual frenzy, pulling the passengers out, shouting and clubbing and herding them toward the main gate. Amidst the crush of passengers, the limp bodies of children occasionally came spilling out onto the platform, and the blue units tossed them into a pile. Engel watched all of this impassively. A woman came out of the train, clutching a child of perhaps 3 years. She looked about frantically, screaming for a doctor, and I gave her a sympathetic look and held out my arms. She approached me, the handsome, stolid-looking authority figure that I am. I took the child from her and tenderly examined it. It was still alive. I placed it gently on the ground and used my boot to reshape its skull. The woman I shot. 38th Post, Rachel Fields. Voiceover script. Rachel does not dream. Rachel does not sleep. Rachel does not wake. Rachel feels all the time. Rachel Head has a direct sense feed with Reinhardt emotive FPS blending for stunning clarity and total sensory presence. With the entire cultural library at her fingertips, Rachel can put herself into any scenario and create precision mixes at speed of mind. Watch as she blends Beethoven's Fifth Symphony with the Asteroid Orbital Catalog, the 2018 World Cup game, and the hot new Anal Coming video from Angelica Elenia. What mastery. See the subtle crafting and non-stuttering blends? That's because Reinhardt's proprietary technology blend splits 240 visual FPS on the fly to create an eye-popping visual stream of over 1,000 FPS, while simultaneously delivering 60 tactile FPS and 60 olfactory FPS. Now, this is salvation. But hey, forget the specs. Check out the feelings. Her Holocaust child victim disco muscle thumps have walls around the world shedding tears and making those real feels. You can't fake this stuff. Are you tired of distant, deadened emotions? Reinhardt's emotive FPS blending gives you realistic immersive feelings without excess rumination or thought linger. This kind of subtlety just isn't possible at an ordinary 240 FPS. That's the difference for Rachel. That can be the difference for you. Rachel does not dream. Rachel does not sleep. Rachel does not live, and Rachel does not die. Rachel feels. Can you? 39th post. A rather perverse request. After a week at the camp, Dr. Enkel put in a rather perverse request. He wanted to move his laboratory to the old gas chamber. I had no problem with this. We had installed new, more efficient gas chambers with the help of an expert on the matter, and although they had a capacity of over 20,000 a day, we were seldom ever able to process more than 15,000 in a single day due to the unreliability of the trains, which were often slow enough to preemptively process many of their passengers for us. At this time, we had orders to cremate the bodies, and they burned in open pits day and night, and we warned Dr. Engel that the old gas chambers would be a rather distracting environment to work in, as it was between the smoke of the burning pits and the noise of the new gas chambers. He disregarded this, and his team moved in that day. After that, I rarely saw him, as that part of the camp was somewhat hidden from the rest, and my headaches, which were now growing more severe, had always made me reluctant to visit. Soon, my men began to tell me strange tales from the new laboratory. Nobody except Engel and his men were allowed inside, but we surmised that he had removed or reduced the chamber's interior walls and sealed up all the doors except one. He requested his own SS detail, and two guards were posted at the door at all times. A steady flow of prisoners went into the laboratory, whom Engel selected with the help of his odious Jew assistant, often to the great irritation of my units, as their fussy selectivity often slowed down our processing activities. Nobody could make any sense of this selection process, as it mainly consisted of the Jew looking the person over and making various mutterings. It was reported that every few days an enormous package wrapped in tarpaulin would be removed from the laboratory and carried over to a special burning pit which they had made. These packages tended to bleed, leaving a trail to the burning pit, a trail of blood, where they were burned under the watch of Engel's personal guard. This behavior was only extraordinary in that there was no need for secrecy when it came to killing prisoners. Thousands were being killed every day just a few meters away in the new gas chamber. Between this and the inexplicable presence of the Jew assistant, I slowly became curious about the project. My men, however, were unable to get any information about what was occurring inside the laboratory. So, I decided to focus a few questions on the member of the team who presumably had the least sense of loyalty. The Jew. On one of our days off, I found the Jew in our little zoo admiring the peacocks. He looked very much at peace as he watched the birds strut around, while I was suffering from vicious headaches. I began to talk to him, affecting an offhand, friendly manner. His German was perfect. I asked him about his background. He told me he had been a religious student in Berlin until he was expelled to a ghetto in Krakow. I asked him how he had met Engel. There he told me something quite surprising. This was actually his second time coming to Treblinka. On his first visit, he was on the very verge of being shot when somebody had noticed his perfect German. Apparently, there had been a request for prisoners who spoke excellent German, and this earned him a reprieve. He was sent back to Berlin, where Engel performed tests on him. I asked about the nature of these tests. At this, he became more reticent. He had been instructed to discuss nothing with me. I merely informed him that I would shoot him through the face if he did not tell me everything. At this, he showed no fear, but he looked at me with his odd, brazen eyes and gave me an almost pitying smile. He said that the doctors were testing a new Swiss invention, something, some kind of chemical, which was administered orally and caused profound changes in thinking. I asked him about these changes. He said that the chemical allowed him to see the mind of God. Naturally, I asked for elaboration. At this, he launched into a rather overworked simile involving a broken mirror, then switched to another simile using a spider's web, neither of which made any sense to me. I informed him that I was a practical man and had little use for philosophy. He told me that after taking the chemical many times, he had become possessed of two minds, his own and that of God. In all his doings, he was conscious of God's intentions, of God's plan for all human life. I asked him if he was following God's plan, and he said he was not following it entirely. I am wrestling this God, he said cryptically. How does one wrestle with God? Isn't he all-powerful? When God presses forward, you must yield, or you will be destroyed. And when God yields, you must press forward. That sounds more like dancing than wrestling, or making love, I said with a snort. He smiled. Yes, it is. Except, dancing is not quite so painful. Why wrestle at all? If God is God and you know his plan, why not simply follow it? Surely this is the best course. Yes, but I cannot bring myself to, he said. For the first time, I saw his peaceful expression flee from his face to be replaced by an unsettling dread that trembled in his eyes. God's plan is... it is simply too awful. 40th Post, Mother Babylon. Imagine Mother Babylon, Mother Rome, Mother America. The world enslaved, flesh networks spanning the globe, the blood of humanity moving through veins thousands of miles long, cavernous tubes big as superhighways, biological superstructures, bones the size of the Golden Gate Bridge, living engineering, hearts as big as mountains pumping with tectonic force chained in relays, moving blood across continents. Exotic neurochemical pestilence flowing from monstrous glandular ridges, flesh encased in nightmares. Farms of non-human tongues babbling blasphemous gibberish. A vast seabed dotted with lonely eyes. This is the great queendom of Babylon. A great blood-drunk whore wearing the crown of the atom, as all around her fleshy carapace float orbital platforms of nuclear death. Scattered in the stars beyond, the seeds of Israel weep to gaze upon their new mother, the undying queen of blood and corruption. I've commented before on the relationship between madness and art. To be driven by the visions in your mind so that you have to get them out in some tangible way. I think that's part of why I'm so fascinated with such horrifying things, that there are people who live every day with this bouncing around between their ears. Well, until next time, stay scary, my wildlings. Don't spend all day in bed, and make the most of your nights.